Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I'm Rebecca Katz. I direct the Center for Global Health Science and Security here at Georgetown University. And I want to welcome you to the final seminar of the 2020-2021 academic year. As we do, as many of you join us monthly, we do a monthly seminar series. And it has been another fascinating but challenging year. Today, we are excited to have three of our very own student researchers from the center, Kate Toole, Emily Pellis, and Kristen Thomas, present and discuss the issue briefs that they've been writing on COVID-19 policy, as well as a presentation from our partner, Justin Kerr of Talis Analytics. These presentations feature data from the COVID Analysis and Mapping of Policies tool, COVID-AMP, as well as data collected through the center, and focus on different aspects of pandemic policy and the implications for future response. Since March of 2020, about a year ago, the center has published 21 issue briefs, in addition to dozens of peer review articles, op-eds, books. We've written a lot of words this year. But we're excited to take today to highlight three and bring these talented authors together for a lively and informative discussion. They will present first, and then we will do questions and answers. And the questions can be done at the, please use the Q&A, the questions and answer tool and the chat box throughout the presentations, pose your questions. And Siobhan will expertly moderate the session towards the end. So, thank you again for joining us today. I'd like to now hand things over to Justin Kerr of Talis Analytics to provide some background on COVID-AMP project and how they've used the data for work with the District of Columbia. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Rebecca. Really excited to be here with you this morning and hear the work the students have been doing in more detail. I'm quite familiar with their work on COVID-AMP, entering all the policies. It's been a heroic effort. So I'll just give a couple of slides, and I think someone's gonna share them for me here. Thanks, Siobhan. But mostly just to highlight some of the views that you can see in the tool and to underscore that the underlying data from COVID-AMP are all publicly accessible, and encourage everyone, not during today's presentations, but hopefully after today, to go and check out the data available for yourself and explore how it can be useful to you, as well as just interact with some of the features of the tool. So COVID-AMP available online at either of those URLs, covidamp.org, will take you directly to the page you see on the left, or covidlocal.org/AMP will get you there. I'd also point you to the whole suite of IDEA tools and resources for global health, studying global health capacity development and disease outbreaks, that we've done in collaboration between Talis Analytics, the center. Lots of great stuff there at ghssidea.org. And to say that there's kind of three parts to AMP, so you can view the policies on a map, as you can see on the left, interact with sort of the intersection between the policies and the epidemiological spread of COVID, as well as access the data directly. So next slide. At its heart, though, COVID-AMP is a comprehensive database of policies enacted in response to COVID-19. I mentioned there's a map, a modeling page, and you can access all of the data, download it, a subset or all of it, and by request, we provide an API for those who want to access the data in a machine-readable way directly. All the data are fully searchable, filterable, and available for download. And over 50 pieces of information about each policy, including legal authorities, designed for a range of analysis cases, and includes preserving those original documents like the PDFs, the screenshots that are unlikely to persist into the future, and capturing those along with the information about the policy. Next slide. So what is inside? You can see the map up to the left, but what's running the engine behind that is an enormous data set coded by the research team at the center and across Georgetown. And it's really has been a tremendous effort, largely driven by the students. 35,000 individual entries, 1,500 unique locations represented in 66 countries. So 66 national level policies and subnational policies in many of those countries, including for the US, all 50 US states, DC and Puerto Rico. And one hallmark we say is a strength of COVID-AMP is that really we're covering a spectrum of policies, everything from contact tracing and vaccination policies through to social distancing, which are those stay-at-home, safer-at-home orders and policies around reopening that have gotten much of the attention, all the way through to military deployment. So really trying to take the most comprehensive picture that we can, still though synthesizing that information so you can get it on a map and get a snapshot if you need that level of information, but dive all the way into the details on the research end. Next slide. Just a few views. This is pulling out New Jersey, but that you can get into all different levels of information, timelines, the individual documents, relative comparisons between different regions and different policy categories if you go to the covidamp.org interactive site. Next slide. Just a couple examples of use cases. You'll hear much richer examples today, but by way of preview of what you can do with these data, in a project supporting the DC Auditor's Office, which actually has come up in a couple of press articles starting this morning since the report went public yesterday. Quite easy to find the full report if you're interested. I recommend just Google DC Auditor and hit the reports button. That's the quickest path to find it. But what we were able to do is in a series of reports, help the district better understand the interplay between their COVID-19 policymaking and how the pandemic unfolded in terms of cases and loss of life in the district, but also provide them perspective for how that related to the national trends that occurred across the country. US, as you well know, has been hard hit by the pandemic relative to many other nations. And within the US, there's been a spectrum of those impacts. So we're trying to understand what differences existed between the most hard hit and less hard hit areas. And in short, you can see the states ordered from left to right here based on case impacts in the fall. And we found that really across two kind of key spectrums of policies, those social distancing policies that regulated what kinds of businesses were open and in what kind of capacity limitations and mitigation procedures, as well as the policies that just supported the general public, like stopping evictions and foreclosures, providing direct relief to essential workers. The states hardest hit had the least policies. Those are the red colored bars on the right. Least policies in both categories, but states that had less impacts took a much more mixed approach, but still had a variety of these policies in place in a more robust way. Next slide. The last one I have is just constructing a more dense timeline, highlighting some of the special elements we see. We've put a lot of attention to in COVID-AMP. For example, this relaxing, restricting element of the data allows us to get different information about what the intent of the policy was. So across a broad range of policies, we can construct these kind of timelines and understand when was the stringency being ratcheted up or down. And that's because the coders that entered this data really took a holistic view and understood what was going in and the context around this policy in order to derive that additional information. And with that, I'll hand it back to today's presenters.
Great, so good morning. Thank you everyone for coming out so early on a Friday morning. My name is Kate Toole. I am a junior in the School of Foreign Service studying science, technology, and international affairs. And today I'll be giving a brief overview of the contact tracing research I've been working on over the past year or so. So just as a brief introduction, contact tracing is an important public tool that's used to prevent transmission of infectious disease. And it's done by interviewing positive cases to identify exposed individuals and quarantine them so that they can't expose anyone else asymptomatically. And so contact tracing data is important for really two key reasons. First, comparing contact tracing data from different jurisdictions can help identify best practices by determining who's doing best. And additionally, if a jurisdiction is unable to interview a high percentage of cases, it's likely overwhelmed with transmission. And so that data can inform policy decisions and resource allocation. Next slide. So to explore this, we looked at contact tracing at both the international and domestic level. For both levels of analysis, we extensively reviewed official government websites publishing COVID-19 data, as well as some peer-reviewed sources where necessary. So for international contact tracing, we performed two reviews, including about 25 case studies, with the second review also including a comparative analysis of about 66 countries, building off of Mackenzie Moore's thesis research. And then for domestic contact tracing, we maintain a publicly available tracker that I'll talk about a bit later that tracks the data transparency practices of all 50 states, DC, and the 10 largest cities in the US. And we have also published periodic reviews of the changes in the tracker to track progress in this area. Next slide, please. So we started with domestic contact tracing, but realized that we really needed benchmarks to compare it to since the indicators were so poor. So that led to the production of the International Contact Tracing Research Project, which I'll introduce first for that context. So accordingly, we sought to encourage data sharing and sort of facilitate conversations regarding best practices for contact tracing, as well as identifying commonalities and confounding factors related to the success of these contact tracing programs, such as governance. Next slide, please. So broadly speaking, we found fairly low levels of data transparency and largely inconsistent metrics across countries that do report data, which makes further analysis of best practices difficult. And we also found a wide variety of contact tracing technologies implemented both within and across different nations where they're used at all. And then as far as those confounding factors that I mentioned on the last slide, the first we highlighted was variation in centralized versus local management of these contact tracing systems. So strong local case management was crucial, but states that had left too much autonomy to local jurisdictions and gave minimal national guidance had less successful outcomes. So some examples of that were often federations like the United States, Australia, Brazil, Mexico, and Spain really struggled with contact tracing initially because there was so much variation at the state or local level. Next, privacy norms and laws played a huge role in the response because countries with more relaxed privacy laws were capable of more invasive case investigations. And lastly, recent experience with infectious disease outbreaks, especially Ebola and polio, led to more prepared community health workforces, which were able to rapidly mobilize and utilize public trust that they had already gained, which led to better outcomes. So next slide. So you can see here on this map sort of the weaknesses in data transparency that I mentioned. Countries in red had no contact tracing data online whatsoever. The countries in blue had some, and the countries in green were publishing comprehensive and useful contact tracing data. So hopefully, in the coming weeks as vaccinations are deployed, it will be easier for health systems to manage outbreaks. This is definitely an area for improvement, both with regard to COVID-19 and for future outbreaks. Next slide, please. And so also, as I mentioned, there's a huge variety of contact tracing apps out there and the technologies they use, using Bluetooth versus GPS versus QR codes, in many cases, multiple apps at the local versus national level. And so this is also something that will be an interesting area for further research to determine what, if any, apps were useful and if that should be a strategy in future infectious disease outbreaks. So next slide. So one case study that I thought it was interesting to highlight was South Korea, because most of this presentation will highlight the need for increased data transparency. South Korea really fell on the other end of that spectrum. So the Korean Centers for Disease Control performs extremely, extremely rigorous case investigations. They actually use credit card history, CCTV footage, and cell phone data to identify the location history of any positive case with the past week of their positive test. And then that information is published along with often demographic data. And so you can see here on the right, this is a publicly accessible map where you can look and see any locations where a positive case has been identified and cross-check that with your own location history to determine whether or not you need to be tested. And the public safety alert at the top is something that the government will release as a push notification so that people can be aware of a location that a positive test has been. And once again, go get tested to ensure that they haven't been exposed. All of the locations where an individual who has tested positive has been will also be carefully cleaned by the CDC. And so what has happened as a consequence of this high transparency is that individuals have been identified by the contact tracing information that has been released. And this has led to harassment and shaming. And so the human rights watch group has been criticizing the government for their superfluous data transparency and encourage them to sort of reduce it in order to protect the identities of those individuals. And so this really was just an example that highlights the tension between public health and the right to privacy, and definitely a balance is what we're looking for moving forward. So next slide. So as a direct contrast to South Korea, I'll now be going into the United States data, which was really characterized by poor transparency across states. So just to introduce our contact tracing tracker. So this is a screenshot of the publicly available contact tracing database. We track 8 key contact tracing metrics, as well as whether or not CDC metrics are reported. And the goal here is really to encourage increased transparency and investment in contact tracing across different states. So next slide. So upon our initial review, which was in July and August, we found extremely poor data transparency with less than 20 states publishing any useful metrics whatsoever. High variability in the metrics used. So different states could not be easily compared to each other even when they were publishing data. And then looking towards the fall, we did see 10 states with some improved transparency. And then with that improved transparency, there were more metrics published, which led to increased overlap. So there was some improved consistency between metrics. But where a lot of this inconsistency stemmed from was a lack of national guidance, because the CDC did not release any guidance until about April of 2020, mid to late April. And that guidance was very loose and not restrictive. And so states were essentially on their own with deciding if to publish any contact tracing metrics whatsoever, and if they did decide which ones to publish. And so moving into late fall with our secondary review, there was continued disregard to CDC guidelines. They appeared to have essentially no influence on what states decided to publish. And what will be interesting to see looking forward is whether or not that changes with a new administration, because in the spring, a new set of CDC contact tracing metrics were released and put for under review. So hopefully that will be changing moving forward. Finally, looking at contact tracing apps across the different states, initially we saw states building their own expensive apps that were receiving poor update. Take and over the past few months, we've definitely seen an expansion of the Google Apple to those apps. So next slide, please. So you can see here the poor data transparency outcomes that I was talking about. On the left slide was our initial review. And so any state in blue is a state that published any contact tracing data whatsoever, excluding congregate living settings, because that's mandated by the federal government and published on a separate website. But the bar for being included on this map was very low. For example, Wyoming publishes the cumulative number of contacts they've identified, and that's it, which is essentially not helpful at all for trying to establish how well a contact tracing system is performing, because you don't know how many cases are being identified, how many cases are being interviewed, things like that. And so transparency was definitely a challenge, especially early on. Moving into the fall, you can see those states that improved, but really broadly speaking, there's still a lot of area for improvement. Next slide. And so here is the contact tracing apps. This is as of October 2020 as well. So you can see here, especially on the Eastern Seaboard, the expansion of the Google Apple exposure notification system. And that's also been being panned out on the West Coast. And so what's positive about that particular system is that it can be integrated across states. So if a positive case from New York travels to Pennsylvania with the New York app on their phone, and they expose someone in Pennsylvania, that person in Pennsylvania with a different app on their phone will still get a notification that they were exposed. And so that integration is definitely something very valuable. Whereas in Utah, for example, their app that they released, that they put about $6 million of investment into, has the actual contact tracing function has been taken off of the app because it received so much negative feedback for lack of transparency and data privacy concerns. So next slide. So overall, our conclusions from the combination of domestic and international contact tracing research are that states should publish clear national guidelines for their contact tracing program early on in the outbreak, And in combination with that, local entities should be legally required to publicly report a specific set of programmatic and case investigation metrics so that those policy takeaways as well as best practices can be determined sooner rather than later. Third, local health departments should be adequately funded to maintain a base of trained community health workers who are prepared to perform contact tracing and rapidly mobilize. And these efforts can be mandated by legislation. And that's something that we saw in other countries in the international case studies. And then finally, technology is something that could be used to support, but it shouldn't be used to replace traditional contact tracing interviews. So continued emphasis should really be placed, as I mentioned, on the human resources and data management rather than apps and things like that. And so with that, I'd just like to thank Mackenzie Moore and Ryan Remmel, who were the other members of the contact tracing research teams, as well as Dr. Katz, Ali, and Jordan for their support and guidance as we worked on these different briefs. So thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. My name is Emily Pellis, and I am a Master of Public Policy student at the McCourt School at Georgetown. And I'm also a research assistant here at the Center for Global Health Science and Security. And for this past academic year, I've had the opportunity to work on COVID AMP, as well as conduct some additional research on COVID-19 policies in California. And I'm looking forward to sharing some of my research on California policies with you today. So to begin, the two major research questions that I set out when I began this project was I first wanted to understand how the population and urbanicity of a given county or city in California impacted that locality's COVID-19 response plan. And I took a look at this in terms of both social distancing measures and other policy measures. And then next, I sought to understand to what extent the counties and cities deferred solely to state guidelines without providing any additional guidance from their local health officials. And I also, on the flip side, wanted to understand to what extent the counties and cities provided more restrictive policies than those put out by the state. Next slide, please. So to begin, I selected a handful of counties and cities within California, and my sampling methods included an effort to include both urban and rural counties. And I looked also at the population level of the localities and their geographic location throughout the state in order to obtain a broad range of different experiences for localities throughout California. And to determine the urbanicity of a given county, I looked at the Office of Management and Budget's Metropolitan Statistical Area designation, and that helped me to define urban versus rural counties within California. And while I looked at a number of localities for this research brief, here today I just want to highlight a few case studies. Next slide, please. So before I dive into the case studies, I'd like to just set the stage to provide a brief overview of what was going on in California at this for state level policy responses. So as you can see on the visual here, it was over a year ago that the state of California declared their state of emergency and enacted a stay at home order back in March of 2020. And it's coming up on a year now that the state began their efforts to reopen various sectors. As you can see, the cases began to spike over the summer and then had another large spike around the winter time and going into 2021. But currently, as you can see here, in last December, the state of California put out its Vaccinate All 58 campaign in an effort to make sure that all 58 counties have access to vaccines and to really encourage vaccine distribution throughout all of the counties in California. Next slide, please. So the three case studies that I'd like to share with you today are Orange County, Madera County, and MoDoc County. Next slide, please. So first, starting with Orange County, I selected Orange County as one of the localities to include in this research project due to its large population. Orange County had the largest population of any county or city that I looked at for this project. And necessarily it was defined as an urban county. And I found when diving deeper into the policies produced by Orange County that the majority of their policies focused on social distancing and restricting movement. And this finding made sense to my preconceived notions about a large population and the necessity of producing policies related to addressing that level of a population. What I found most interesting about looking at Orange County is that I compared it with Santa Ana, which is the city within Orange County, and it's actually the county seat and second largest city in Orange County. And by comparing Santa Ana's policies to Orange County, I saw that Santa Ana focused primarily on enabling and relief measures, which were directed at both the general population of their city and the private and public sectors. And this comparison really helped me to understand the difference between what a city government is able to address as far as their COVID policies and what falls under the jurisdiction of county level government. Next slide, please. Next, I chose to look at Madera County, which has a mid-sized population. That's the county is located in the central region of the state, and the Office of Management and Budget classifies it as an urban county, but I would say that from doing a little research, it has traits of both urban and rural elements. And what I found from Madera County, my research on their COVID policies, is that the county frequently defers to state level guidance, but when necessary, it has also developed its own policy measures. And those policy responses have primarily focused on social distancing and contact tracing. More recently, the county has also focused on their vaccination plans. Next slide, please. Finally, I chose to look at Modoc County, which is a county with a small population. It's located in the northeast corner of the state of California, and this is classified as a rural county. And what I found with Modoc County is that their policies primarily focus on social distancing, but as you can see on this visual here, what's interesting about Modoc County is that they did not begin to develop any policies until the summer of 2020. And that was also when they had their first COVID-19 case reported in the county. So what I inferred from that is that prior to the summer, Modoc County simply deferred to state level guidelines, but once COVID-19 hit a little bit closer to home for the county, it became necessary to actually develop their own policy response to address the needs of residents within their county. Next slide, please. So I have a number of key takeaways from this research project. And the first, as I sort of mentioned, looking at Orange County and Santa Ana, is that this helped me to understand the role of each level of government in pandemic response. And I found that in general, the county, city, and state policies all addressed specific issue areas that fell within their respective jurisdictions. And so many of the differences between city and county level policy responses can be attributed to those different functions of city and county governments. And so one example, just to highlight this a bit further, is that the county would not have jurisdiction over city-sponsored utilities. This was something that I saw Santa Ana addressing, and it made sense that that fell within their jurisdiction and that they would be the better suited entity to address this sort of policy response. And similarly, policies related to reducing the spread of the virus in county jails had to originate at the county level. And that's something that I saw in Orange County. And so I think this provides a good example of understanding the various functions of city and county governments and how they can work together to guide their policy responses to the COVID-19 pandemic. I also saw, as I mentioned here with Orange County and Santa Ana, it was very clear the interaction and cooperation that occurred between various levels of government. And one really interesting finding was that independent of urban or rural classification, I saw that every locality did operate within the framework of the state's policy guidelines. And so we also can infer from that that there's interaction and cooperation with the state as well. I would say that the cooperation with state guidelines was most apparent for localities that simply either reposted state policies on their websites or created their own policies in order to inform and relay information to their residents. As the figure that you can see on the right shows, I found that the volume of pandemic response policies produced by a locality was often larger for urban localities And that finding holds regardless of county or city classification. And I think this makes sense just thinking about different constraints with population level and why it may be necessary to produce more policies related, particularly to social distancing or contact tracing for localities with a larger population. And so finally, what I'd like to leave you with today is that one lesson from the California COVID-19 response policies that I studied is just the real importance of collaboration, communication, and coordination across all levels of government. And this is something that we're seeing now with the vaccine distribution as well. And so I think that's something to keep in mind for future public health responses. Thank you all.
Good morning. My name is Kristen Thomas, and I am thrilled to be able to speak with you today about some popular policy. I will specifically be speaking about state legislative bans on employer vaccination requirements. For a bit of personal background, I am a JD candidate at the Georgetown University Law Center. I'm in the evening program a third year, and I will graduate in the class of 2022. I'm also a COVID-19 legal research assistant here at the Georgetown University Center for Global Health Science and Security. And I am a COVID-19 and HIV and AIDS research assistant at the Georgetown University O'Neill Institute for National and Global Health Law. I have experience in the fields of public health, public policy, public affairs, and social and behavioral sciences. I have some legislative experience and I know a bit about healthcare, so this was the perfect project for me. Next slide. So, state legislative bans on employer vaccination requirements, what are they? They are laws that prevent employers from requiring current and prospective employees to get vaccinated as a condition of employment. These bans are a response to the COVID-19 pandemic and the public health safety measures that have been implemented as a result, the development of COVID-19 vaccines, and the distribution of COVID-19 vaccines in the United States. Next slide. The purpose of my research was to examine these bans and also analyze the implications of them for employers, employees, and the general public in the United States. Next slide. For my method, I conducted searches in Legiscan, which is a nonpartisan legislative tracking and reporting service to find proposed state bans on employer vaccination requirements. And I did this in two rounds, first in March and then in April. I used the search terms employer vaccination and immunization. And once I found relevant bans, I reviewed them for their states of origin, party sponsorship, disease specificity, employer specificity, common objections, which really refer to religious, medical, and moral exemptions, legal remedies, dates of effectiveness and expiration, and common themes and words. Next slide. In the April data, I found 75 bans in 39 states. That's a lot. In the March data, I found 56 bans in 32 states. These bills are growing in popularity over time. They're getting consideration in and out of committee, and there's just a great deal of movement on them. I actually had to do my research twice in order to keep up, and I will be rewriting my research brief to make sure that it is current. The presentation today is focusing on the data that was compiled by April 16th, 2021, and you all are the first to hear about it. Next slide. So what's happening? Most of them are still in consideration. Some have failed, but it's important to note that two have actually passed. One bill passed and it was vetoed, and another bill passed and it was signed. I will be speaking about those very briefly. And in addition, it's also important to know that these bans have been introduced multiple times in many states. The graph on the right is a bit distorted, but it shows in the blue that those are the states that introduced one of these bans. But more than half of the states in my study introduced 2, 3, or 4 bans. So legislatures are intent on getting this legislation through. Next slide. Here you can see the veto bill from Governor Tony Evers of Wisconsin. That was Assembly Bill 1, which was passed and vetoed. And you can see a tweet from Lieutenant Governor Deirdre Henderson from Utah. And in that tweet, she's showing herself and Governor Cox of Utah signing this bill and other, signing Utah Bill, 308 and other pieces of legislation into law. A ban is actually in place right now in Utah. Next slide. So who's sponsoring these bills? Who's supporting them? In this graph, a bit distorted again. However, the blue shows all of the bills that are sponsored by only Republicans, while the orange, which would be about 16%, shows the bills that have at least one Democratic sponsor. Most of these are Republican bills. And if you guessed it, Tony Evers is a Democrat, and Lieutenant Governor Henderson and Governor Cox are Republicans. Next slide. For disease specificity, what diseases do these bills focus on? Most of the bills actually are not COVID-19 specific. On the left, in the blue, that represents all of the bills that pertain to all diseases. Many of them mention diseases like the flu. Whereas in the orange, that represents the bills that only pertain to COVID-19. These bills are truly expansive. They're really not only for the pandemic that we are currently in. And on the right, you'll also see just a layout of all of the states that have introduced one of these bans. And in blue, you'll see the states that have at least one bill that pertains to all diseases, while only the states in orange pertain to only have bills that only pertain to COVID-19. Next slide. With regard to employer specificity, most of the bills pertain to all employers, while some pertain to specific employers or all employers with exceptions or specific employers with exceptions. Some of these specific employers are healthcare facilities, you might have guessed. And some of the specific exceptions pertain to healthcare workers. Many times there is a different standard for the vaccination of healthcare workers due to the care that they provide and their proximity to a lot of different people. Next slide. However, many of the bills also provide a way for even healthcare workers to circumvent some vaccination requirements. And those come in the form of common objections, your medical objections, your religious objections, and your moral objections. Six bans, I want to mention, employ these as the sole means by which employees can circumvent employer vaccination requirements in their bills. Originally, I was thinking that I might want to take these out of my data. However, when I looked closer at the data, I saw that the exemptions often include these moral exemptions based on personal beliefs, philosophical reasons, personal objections, and conscience related issues. And when you think about those objections, they can be claimed by almost anyone. So they're quite broad and they really do provide an overall ban on employer vaccination mandates. And I will add that some of the objections for specific populations that are included, again, pertain to physicians, healthcare workers, and also first responders. Next slide. For legal remedies, most of these bills do not actually identify a legal remedy or a way that employees can be made whole if they're adversely affected by employer vaccination requirements. However, some of them do allow for civil action. One of the bills allows for unemployment compensation, And one of the bills actually allows for criminal action. In a Kansas bill, if an employer decided to implement an employer vaccination requirement after this bill was passed, that employer could be subject to a non-person felony. That was pretty crazy to me. Also on your right, you'll see a mention of dates of effectiveness and expiration. And some of the bills are effective immediately upon passage. Some are effective when an emergency is declared. Some require an emergency to be declared. Some have slight delays in effectiveness, and some have sunset dates, meaning that they may go into effect, but a few years later, they will expire and they will need to be passed again. Next slide. With respect to common themes and words, I saw discrimination used a lot. I also saw rights used a lot. With discrimination, it was the idea that employers would be discriminating against employees if they required them to get vaccinated when that employee did not want to get vaccinated. And it was interesting that many of the bills aligned this type of supposed discrimination with discrimination that is widely codified in law, like discrimination based on race or sex. With regard to rights, and I gave some examples there, there was the right of bodily integrity, the right of bodily autonomy, and the right of self-determination. I saw those quite a few times, but there was no recognition of the right of individuals, other individuals, or the right of the public not to be sick. There was also no mention of the duty of the state to protect the public health and prevent the spread of disease. Next slide. So why do we care? Why should we monitor these bans? Well, first, as I've established, these bans are popular. Second, these bans have the potential to pass. Two have already passed. And while one was vetoed, one was signed into law. Also, state legislatures are still in session. Many will be in session into the summer. And so they have plenty of time to get more of these bans passed. And as you know, by the fact that I had to do my research twice within the span of a month, things move very quickly at the state level. We should monitor these bans because they could have widespread implications for employer plans to get employees back to work, for the allocation of employer resources, the allocation of government resources, employee health and rights, and also the health of the general public. In addition, we need to monitor these bans because we need balance. We want to get people back to work. We want to boost the economy, but we also need to protect public health. We also want to preserve community. And while we need to respect individual rights, we must make sure that everyone is taken care of. Lastly, we need to monitor these bans because they can provide dangerous precedent. I'm sorry to say, but COVID-19 will not be the last public health threat. And so we need to be prepared. And employer vaccination requirements can actually be useful to overcome some of the vaccine hesitancy in the United States. Next slide. For next steps, I will be looking forward to the release of this research brief. And I'm also looking forward to delving into vaccine passport requirements. I've started that research, and I'm also looking forward to delving into student vaccination requirements. I will be looking to see if states have implemented state legislative bans on these issues, and if they're thinking about them in the future. I would like to thank Dr. Alexandra Phelan, Dr. Rebecca Katz, and Siobhan Robinson Marshall for their support. And thank you everyone for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Kristen. And if Emily and Kate, you all could turn your videos on so that we can get started. But first, I just want to thank you all for such wonderful presentations. There is really a tremendous amount of work that was put in. I mean, Kristen talking about needing to overhaul her project. You know, Kate and Mackenzie have been working on this contact tracing tool for months, you know, and Emily, there are 58 counties in California, and that is just a huge undertaking to really deep dive and look into them. And so I just want to thank you all, because this is really amazing work, and it's really wonderful to see. And so, yeah, just moving into Q&A, you know, we all were talking yesterday when we went through our run through, but it's really interesting, this common theme of autonomy and kind of privacy versus public good that has arose out of all of your projects, interestingly enough. So it's really, really cool to see. And so we'll just get started with the first question we have. And this one is posed to Kristen. And so Bradley Thomas asks, did you find any correlation between proposed or enacted state legislation placing bans on employer vaccination requirements and the social determinants of health or the social vulnerability factors in those states which have introduced such legislation?
So that question comes from my dad. So thank you, Dad, for asking that question. However, I did not include that in my research. I think that that could definitely be a next step for this project. I think it's incredibly important to consider how the bans may affect the social determinants of health over time. And, you know, perhaps there could be a case study done on Utah, since they now have one of these bans in place. We could see what happens with the population moving forward.
Thank you. And I'd like to ask a question to Kate. So it's really interesting hearing what you were talking about with the contact tracing and, you know, just the stark differences. I think it's very interesting that you had to turn international first just to kind of get a baseline and understanding. So I'm curious what your thoughts are on how we can better incorporate privacy law into, you know, contact tracing and stuff. So we've seen like kind of both ends of the spectrum. And so how do we, as Kristen mentioned, I really like that you had at the end of your presentation, balance. So like for you, what is the balance or the midpoint in this? And obviously that's like a very large question, but just, yeah, I'd love to hear your thoughts.
Yeah, sure, absolutely. So certainly a priority when leaning on the more transparent end of the spectrum is to protect the identity of individuals who are contact traced. So all positive cases should have their identities protected. But at that same time, I do think that, you know, the right to public health and the right to health should take priority when considering participation in these contact tracing systems. So I do think that moving towards perhaps even mandating participation in these contact tracing programs could be a potential avenue for sort of finding that balance. But definitely public trust has been a challenge with regard to these contact tracing systems. So particularly communities of color have been distrustful of, you know, governments investigating and things like that. And so progress has been made with, you know, who can we hire? How can we integrate community health in these communities? But I think prioritizing privacy will be an important part, and protecting those identities will be an important part of improving public trust in community health systems and increasing engagement with contact tracing so that we can have more people participate in the actual systems.
Thank you. Yeah, and I find that really interesting too, thinking about Kristen's presentation, talking about how many you know, employer bans have come out and how quickly we've seen that governments are able to act when they choose, and versus, you know, with the contact tracing, there was that kind of that gap in the beginning for the US because there was no guidance. So, you know, it can be done, but it's interesting what the barriers are. And so turning to Emily, I'd like to ask you to speak a little bit more about how do you think the interplay between state and local governments should be? You know, I think, you know, often there's kind of a tension where it's should states have more power, but then kind of also respecting county or just smaller governments, you know, true understanding of their communities and what their populations look like and what their needs are. You know, your example of Modoc County and it being a rural county and them not having policies until July, you know, was that I mean, did it make sense for them? Was that successful? Should the state have been had more power? So yeah, I'd just love to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, thank you. That's a great question. And I think it sort of fits with the theme of balance that we've seen across Kate and Kristen's projects as well. I think there has to be some sort of balance between the two, between local and state level governments. But I think something that I found was just the communication and coordination between those different levels of government really seems to be key for having that understanding. And I think that's something now, especially with vaccine rollout, that is being prioritized in California, is making sure that proper levels of vaccines are being distributed based on population and based on county needs, based on the number of cases in a given locality. So I think just open communication, obviously it's a very fluid situation that's changing rapidly, often changing daily. And so I think, yeah, I think that a balance between both levels of government is critical for just maintaining the best public health response possible.
Thank you. So I'm curious, from all of you, and you know, you all talked about your methods and you know how you came across this data, and I know some of you used AMP data, but I'm curious what your experience was with finding information and finding this data. Like, how challenging was it? What was publicly available? I know Kate had mentioned kind of challenges with that. So you know, if any of you would like to speak on that, and if you feel like there is a need for, you know, I know Kate, with contact tracing, there was a distinct need for more transparency, but if Kristen and Emily, you all found similar issues.
So I didn't have a problem finding the information. LegiScan is really a great nonpartisan tool that, you know, researchers, you know, politicians, staffers alike can use to get what they need. However, for me, it was really about keeping up with the information. And at times there was a lag in what was passed and what was published. So I did have to try my best to account for that. So what I would do was I would check a bill numerous times, you know, in my search week, in my search period, to just make sure that I didn't miss anything and I was as thorough as possible.
I definitely agree with Kristen's comment on checking things multiple times and the situation changing very rapidly. I was fortunate to be able to use COVID AMP data for my project, and that was very helpful to have the research team updating those routinely. I did also go into the specific locality government websites as well, just to get an understanding of how they were addressing these policies and making them available to their constituents and their residents. But yeah, I felt very fortunate to be able to turn to COVID AMP and to utilize all of that really great research that we have available.
We didn't have to do any FOIA requests to get our information, thankfully.
But yes, as you sort of introduced, Siobhan, there was definitely part of the challenge with transparency was a lack of access to the data. And so despite the fact that there's been a lot of progress made with transparency with regard to cases and deaths, and a lot of different states and localities are using really transparent dashboards, a lot, particularly early on, of the contact tracing data was buried in long PDFs that were released on a bi-weekly or monthly basis, which makes it difficult to keep track of progress and also difficult for somebody who's interested as a member of the public to find. And we've definitely seen positive improvements in that area. A number of different states have released independent contact tracing dashboards with additional metrics, but yeah, definitely accessibility in addition to transparency is an area for improvement.
Thank you. And Kate, this next question is actually for you as well. Did you observe any correlation between levels of contact tracing and which political party controls the executive and or legislative levels of power in those states or counties?
That's a really interesting question. It's not an analysis that we specifically ran, but I think if you look back on the map that I showed earlier on in the presentation with regard to transparency, not that you would have memorized, but a lot of the Midwest was absent, whereas the coastal states were publishing more data. And so sort of based on a, you know, really broad overview of that sort of data, I would say most likely it definitely makes an impact, but certainly an area to look into in the future.
Very interesting, thank you. And this next question is also for you, Kate. Do you think that based on the contact tracing experience across the US with varying degrees of success or sophistication, that the US as a whole will be able to use the contact tracing workforce used during COVID for the next pandemic or public health emergency?
So great question. So one of the challenges that the US had early on, as I sort of mentioned, was the lack of a prepared community health network. And so a lot of contact tracing, a lot of people hired for contact tracing have been temporary hires that are not necessarily community health workers. So that's, you know, college students who haven't found a job because of COVID, or just different people. And so I'm not necessarily sure that that's a reliable workforce moving forward. So I still think that's an area for investment in just sort of our community health systems as a whole, so that those people are there working in communities even when they're not performing contact tracing specifically related to an infectious disease outbreak. Turkey, for example, has national legislation that mandates that a certain number of people at any given time are trained in contact tracing and how those teams would function in the event of an outbreak. That was published, that legislation was released like in the early 1900s. And it's the reason that they were able to mobilize their contact tracing workforce so quickly. And so I think something like that would be required before I would say that this healthcare workforce is prepared to respond to the next outbreak.
Thank you. And I think we have time for just one more question, and this one is for Kristen. Kristen, did you observe any states that invoke the right to health / right not to get sick in their COVID restrictions or laws?
Absolutely. 18 bills. Invoke the right to health, the right to not get sick, you know, the right to choose your treatment. I saw every variation of that in my research. And so that's more than a fifth of the bills that I found in the April data set. So yes, that was extremely popular. And although not too surprising, you know, that approach was taken.
Great. Thank you so much, Kristen. And thank you to all of our presenters, Kate, Emily. This was really wonderful. Thank you again to everybody for joining us today. Also bright and early, or hopefully maybe you live in a different time zone and it's a bit later. But as we mentioned before, Kristen and Emily's briefs are up on our website and published. And Kate and Emily's briefs are up and published, and Kristen's will be up very shortly. Thank you everyone for joining us this morning. And this is our last seminar, I believe, of the 2020-2021 academic year. So thank you for a wonderful season. And we'll close there. Thank you.